Hello and welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall, where bad comics burn. Time to once again take a look at an interesting series of stories all centered around the idea of Stan Lee, known for his contributions to Marvel, reimagining the DC stable of characters. It's like a reboot that doesn't count! It's been a mixed bag so far. Some of the stories have been pretty good, but some people have criticized them as being derivative of other Stan Lee stories, or even other heroes entirely. Like Green Lantern basically just being Swamp Thing with more handsome features. It's not entirely unfounded, but at the same time, these were produced in the early 2000s. They're not gonna necessarily be the most original concepts anymore, because there have been 40 plus years of superhero characters created between them and Stan Lee's most prolific stuff. And even if they're similar to other characters, there's still plenty of storytelling potential with the characters that could put them on different paths. Plus, they've so far at least all been pretty fun and interesting. And frankly, after last week's New 52 origin for Dwella Dent, I kinda like the palate cleanser of something fun and interesting versus something trying desperately to stomp on fun and interesting. Let's dig into Just Imagine Stan Lee creating Aquaman and see how the King of Atlantis fared.
Welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall, where bad comics burn. Linkara's gonna teach you all a lesson you won't learn. What's with these awkward subjects? What's all this art so rubbish? To anyone who's had a bad comic published, it could be your turn.
The cover's pretty good, at least in overall composition, featuring the standard of these things, with our central heroes surrounded by panels of the comic. What makes it work well here is the way they're broken up, with what look like torrents of water, and frankly, the design for this Aquaman is rather cool, almost as if he was made of water himself. There's an alternate cover featured on the back, which makes him more translucent, and has got a really gorgeously painted sunset sky, but I think I prefer the main one because we get a better look at this Aquaman. Honestly, the only thing that drags it down is the choice of panels is not particularly exciting. A dolphin, three angry-looking guys, and then two people whose expressions can best be summed up as, well,
dull surprise!
We open with this guy, Ramon, talking to his girlfriend on a splash page about how awesome the seas are.
People should think more about the seas all around us, Amelia. I mean, is no one even wondering why my chemistry work desk is in the middle of water? It's weird!
Yeah, artistic license.
Well, everyone isn't a wound-up environmentalist like you, lover.
But it's so important. Most of our planet is covered by water.
And yet none of it pays taxes! They're actually on a houseboat, with Ramon talking to his girlfriend, Amelia.
You know, Amelia, sometimes I suspect my work bores you.
It's not your work, honey. It's the fact that you talk about it all the time.
You're right. Let's just watch a movie. I've got, Deep Blue Sea, Jaws, Leviathan, The Meg.
She thinks with his intelligence, he could be making a lot of money working for some company, but he clearly cares more about his environmentalism work.
Then we could talk about the really important stuff, like shopping and partying and going to romantic places. Preferably with your money instead of mine. I'm such a likable character.
To be fair, I do sympathize with her because he admits he needs to stop making out with her so we can test a water sample before it dilutes. So, yeah, I get how annoying it can be to be around someone who won't shut the hell up about the same topic over and over, but she's also presented as kind of vapid and vain, so I kept expecting it to be revealed that she was cheating on him. She is not, though. Someone pulls up to the houseboat.
Freeze, you two!
And it turns out to be Ramon's brother, Frank, just holding Ramon's cell phone that he left on the deck. It's funny because it's terrifying to think of a cop pointing a gun at you. Frank brought some food over for lunch. Namely, he brought all the food. Pizza, gyros, presumably some Chinese. I love me some Asia. Frank also doesn't really care for Ramon's environmentalism. Their dad was a cop too, and Frank thinks that no one will be around to enjoy the ocean if there's too much crime. Ramon's attitude is that if pollution destroys the planet, crime's gonna be the least of their worries. While Amelia probably thinks that the real way to save the world is to do more shopping. That way, everyone gets the items that they want, and nobody will care about polluting or robbing things. To be more accurate about their dad, he was actually in the Coast Guard. Thus, the two sons have kind of split his profession, and Ramon sees his environmentalism as his own way of honoring him.
He fought everything from terrorism to fires, and I'll be fighting pollution and oil spills.
Fair enough, but I think that oil spill is pretty well contained in the tiny amount of water it's in. How did that boat even get in there? Frank is called away to deal with a break-in while Ramon tries to show Amelia the beauty of the ocean by watching a sunset, but she says she's seen it a million times.
Not just the sunset, Amelia. The water. The wonderful, miraculous, life-giving water.
Life-giving water. Nectar of the gods.
He says his experiment with water is gonna win him a Nobel Prize.
Ramon, Ramon, Ramon. It's a good thing I love you, cause sometimes you sound like you're one shoe short of a pair.
You won't think that in a few days, after I show you the power of water.
Ramon became despondent when he learned that the super soaker had already been invented.
I promise, Amelia, it'll all make sense to you very soon.
That's what scares me. I hope what you've got isn't contagious.
If I'm right, my plan could change the world.
Oh boy, it turns out this is gonna be a supervillain origin.
Here's the world's most unnecessary caption. The next day. As if you wouldn't have known.
Calendar watch and Stan.
Then why did you bring it up?
Look, maybe Amelia should be showing more interest in her boyfriend's passions, but at the same time, dude, she's clearly not into it, and you've arranged your date to be at an aquarium. He seems to be doing this to try to have her guess what his experiment is about, but like, why would she pick up on that? All you do is talk about water and the ocean, so she probably assumes it's just a continuation of your obsession with it. So, what does this experiment of his actually involve? Injecting himself with the DNA of various species of underwater life to allow him to breathe underwater!
Of course! Don't you know anything about science?
You know, Ramon, this was a Sideshow Bob plan on a Simpsons episode! Oh my god, that plot wasn't in a Treehouse of Horror episode, what the hell? They go out on a date the next day on his boat, where Amelia tries to show off her skimpy bikini. However, in his rush out the door, Ramon misses a fax message warning people about pirate hijackers in the bay.
Hey, I just remembered something. What was it that you said you wanted to show me?
Leave the bridge and come on deck.
But you're both already on the deck. What?
I want you to appreciate it with no distractions.
30 minutes later.
Well, was it worth it?
Took you half an hour to change into a bikini? I mean, I suppose it could have just been banging for half an hour, but now Ramon is diving into the water to try to demonstrate that he can breathe underwater now. But instead of just saying that, he merely says,
"Be aware, I'm taking no oxygen supply."
Dude, your girlfriend has like 3 interests. Buying crap, partying, and not talking about water. Maybe it's time to stop trying to make her guess stuff and instead just come out and say what you mean. However, when he goes underwater, something weird is going on in it.
What? I don't get it. Why is the water glowing this way?
Well, suddenly I have a refreshing mint flavor.
Just here, in this area, it's a strange green color.
The government program to put chlorine in the ocean isn't going very well. He soon spots a shark on approach, thinking that it must have been attracted to the glow. After swimming through the green water, the shark suddenly decides to turn away and swim off. Ramon doesn't notice all his equipment falling off of him until he looks at himself and sees that he's suddenly transformed into, well, this.
The DNA! The strange green water! They've turned me into an undersea freak!
Man, who knew that injecting yourself with the DNA of other animals could lead to bad things? He climbs back up onto the boat, feeling like he's actually part of the water, but once he's out of it, he reverts back to normal. Amelia, none the wiser about what just happened, other than to say,
I thought you intended to stay down longer.
She's also reading a magazine during this, so just goes to show how attentive she was to your little test, dude. He drives the boat in circles, trying to find the green water again, probably to get a sample, but he can't find it. As such, he just settles in to make out with Amelia,
But then their ship is boarded. Oh no, cock-block the pirate! Ramon decides to fight and does a decent job of it, but is soon knocked out and tossed in the water when they can't find a wallet on him. However, as soon as he's in it again, he transforms back into the water form. Amelia jumps in out of fear of them, but Ramon, now able to retain the water form, comes back onto the deck and is able to fight the pirates pretty effectively. He's basically Spider-Man villain Hydro-Man now. Bullets pass right through him, he can shoot water out of himself that's as powerful as a bullwhip, and send out small waves of water to knock them away. He intends to just call the Coast Guard on them, but then when he remembers Amelia, who isn't a great swimmer, he dives back in to save her. Fortunately, the Coast Guard does arrive to arrest the pirates, and later Amelia wakes up with Ramon in his convertible. And I guess either he waited for the Coast Guard to leave and just abandoned his boat, or the Coast Guard didn't bother to ask, hey, should we bring your girlfriend to the hospital in case there's secondary drowning? Nah, it's probably fine. Amelia doesn't really question any of this either. I'm bustin' to tell her what happened to me. So you're saying that bustin' would in fact make you feel good. Later, he tests out his powers at the aquarium, able to transform into his Aquaman form at will. He can adjust the spray of the water jets and the pressure he exerts with them strong enough to cut through metal. He can adjust his density in various parts of his body, so his fists can punch people while the rest of him's still fluid, but one drawback is that he can't ooze through small spaces. His overall shape has to remain consistent. It's not like he can Alex Mack himself anywhere. This doesn't explain where the excess water comes from, like he needs to rehydrate himself constantly, or if he's actually bleeding parts of himself when he does this, but it doesn't seem like that's a major concern. Best part is, I can become myself again with just a thought. But the worst part is, I've turned myself into a freak! Okay, dude, this isn't like Ben Grimm. Sure, your powers are kind of freaky-deaky, but you can control your appearance. It's not like you're in the water form 24/7 now and can't have a normal life anymore. You could always just never use this power again. This isn't what I had wanted! I just wanted to mutate my body with animal DNA so I could breathe underwater! Nothing freak-like about that! Needing to tell someone about all this, Ramon heads to his brother's place. The two drive off so he can show him his powers, but they don't notice a car following them. Once at the local reservoir, he transforms into his Aquaman form, but the guys who were following attack. The pirates, who apparently were released, I'm guessing on bail, or maybe if Ramon didn't return to the boat, the Coast Guard couldn't prove they were actually trying to be pirates. They shoot at Frank, apparently not seeing the transformation. Frank's hit in the leg, but is otherwise okay. Aquaman chases after the pirates. He can't fly, but he can propel himself forward like water shooting through a hose, probably a result of the controlling water pressure thing. However, before he can catch up to them, they round a corner too fast and crash into the back of a garbage truck, exploding their own car. Though the garbage truck is mostly intact.
I'll just take a breather with this panel. No caption of mine can explain it any better than Scott's great drawing.
Stan, you haven't been saying anything but the time captions. Wait. Have you been providing narration and the letterer forgot to put it in or something? Ramon isn't particularly heartbroken about the pirates blowing up, but he's definitely feeling bad about his brother. One of the repeated criticisms of this series, though, is that they all feature a loved one dying. But that's not the case here. They're later at the hospital, and Ramon learns that Frank likely won't be able to walk again, blaming himself for the incident. Frank, however, is optimistic that he'll overcome this and doesn't blame Ramon for any of this. It's good stuff. Still, Ramon says that now that he has this power, he'll use it to fight crime for the sake of his brother until he's back on his feet. And hey, Ramon's got a confidant now with this whole thing.
Through a magic known only to comic book fans, we now see Frank Raymond a few weeks later.
Stan Lee had apparently never heard of a crossfade in movies. Frank is using his leg brace and cane to walk around and decides he needs to rest for a minute, spotting our old villainous pal Dominic Dark's Church of Eternal Empowerment. He goes in as the congregation, all wearing purple robes, are listening to Dark's sermon about power and the dark side of the force or whatever. Frank, of course, doesn't buy it, but he can tell the congregation is hypnotized. However, Dark's associate, Morgana, can sense an unbeliever in the crowd.
With but a gesture, I freeze time itself. Let all be motionless as I unleash my mystic probe. Apparently, I can stop time, but I can't defeat any of the superheroes who have sprung up lately. Go figure.
Dark can sense that Frank poses a future danger for them, and Morgana- Wow! Okay, Yeah, check out Morgana's outfit here. Apparently the headdress forms into, like, a bra for her with emeralds over it, and she's even wearing a collar and chain. Just imagine Stan Lee creating a kink party. Dark can sense that it's not Frank who's the issue, but that he's connected to it. As such, they decide not to harm him and just observe from afar. And indeed, Frank is soon arriving at the houseboat to inform Ramon and Amelia of what he saw at the church.
No, seriously, Ramon, she's like completely topless, but somehow the thing on her head drapes down and covers her boobs. I'm joining that religion!
They're concerned about it, but they should be even more concerned since Dark and Morgana observe all this. Dark can sense the power inside of Ramon and instructs Morgana to do something about- Wow, okay! So the chain on her collar is connected to, like, some kind of metal piece or something covering up her naughty bits. I am legitimately impressed by how over the top this outfit is. Okay, in another panel we see that the thing is actually supposed to be connected to her robes to cover up her lower half, but that is not evident in the first panel. Wow. Also, she dispatches their robe servants to go and kill Ramon. Amelia heads off to go to a club, sad that Ramon won't accompany her since he's going to help Frank with his physical therapy.
You know, Rom, it's really strange. We don't seem to have all that much in common. I mean, I'd never go help my family with physical therapy instead of going to a club.
But they're still into each other regardless, and she drives off.
Uh-oh, why do I sense some coming danger? Kinda like the instinct of some fish.
Somehow I don't think my fish sense is tingling is gonna take off. Also, I call bullcrap on this. Even if that is true, that's dumb. Like, seriously, Stan, why? What is gained by giving him a danger sense? What the hell does that have to do with the water?
Ugh.
Anyway, the goons have shown up and grabbed Frank, wanting to know where Aquaman is, but of course our hero quickly arrives.
Whoever you are, you'll live to regret invading this boat.
Trespassing. Truly their worst crime. Naturally, there's nothing they can do to him, and Aquaman is able to toss them around, but then they hit on the idea of using Frank as a hostage. They force the two onto a nearby boat, demanding Aquaman explain who he is and what is this strange power he has. They get ready to kill Frank when Aquaman is insolent, but Ramon is able to get a perfect shot off on the guy's hand, forcing him to drop the gun. The two make short work of the goons, but instead of calling the cops, which, you know, failing to testify against the pirates is apparently what got this situation going, they just let the boat return to Dark and Morgana. The two, I guess, have just been waiting on the docks for them instead of watching with their magic mirror thing, and when one of the goons says that all that remains of their prisoners is a little puddle of water, Dark orders Morgana to kill them without learning anything more. Ramon ends up going to the party and meets up with Amelia, and so our comic ends with Frank contemplating what just happened.
Rob's happy as a lark.
Who the hell is Rob?
But there are forces out there. Forces determined to capture him and destroy him. Forces whose fate is somehow inexorably entwined with Aquaman's. Forces more powerful than anyone suspects. Their sexy outfit technology is centuries ahead of ours.
This comic is pretty damn good overall. There's, of course, plenty of silliness, like Morgana's outfit or Dark acting like an idiot near the end, but it's a pretty solid origin story and a fairly original set of powers. For a 40-page story, the pacing is actually really well done, and you've got a solid foundation here for a lot of stories above the ocean or below it, with wiggle room to explore interpersonal relationships with his girlfriend, his brother, finding out horrible side effects to his powers, the mystery of what the green water was, that sort of thing. The pencils on the issue are by Scott McDaniel, whose work I'm not the biggest fan of, but this is one of his better examples. The art is, pun fully intended, very fluid, with action that really shows off constant movement and flow, but thankfully restraining it during the low-key moments. Panels are admittedly a little crowded with stuff at times, but not so distracting that it'd be hard to look at. The energy level is right at the point that it should be. Overall, it's just a pretty good book and one of the best we've seen of these. Next time, back to Patreon-sponsored reviews with a storyline from a webcomic. Normally I wouldn't do that, but the patron made a pretty convincing argument for it, and we'll talk about it more next week.
I'm sitting on my couch reviewing comics, but the world's burnt to joy.
God, I wish there was a caption here to let me know if this was the next day. What time is it?
Hello, my friends. Please take a moment to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and click the bell for notifications on new video releases. If you'd like to support future videos, you can check out my Patreon or purchase a t-shirt via Teespring or Shark Robot. Thanks for watching!